Welcome back to Tangata Pasifika's look at Pacific suicide. We're asking, why are our young people so vulnerable, especially second and third generation families?
It's thought that island-born children are less vulnerable than New Zealand-born kids.
There is really clear evidence that kids that grow up in the islands are much more secure. They have much lower rates of depression and anxiety compared to not just Polynesians growing up here, their cousins and family growing up here, but also to mainstream New Zealand. So, for example, my uncles and aunties back home in the islands, I would have spent a lot of time with. Growing up in New Zealand, I don't spend a lot of time with them. And so if mum and dad aren't in good shape, I haven't got any other adults that I've got a strong enough relationship to that I can, that can help dissipate my distress or alleviate my distress.
He says living in the city is challenging for New Zealand-born families.
There are consequences of not having that sort of financial security, stability, and so it leads to families not necessarily being as cohesive, parents not being able to give as much of their time, quality time, to young people. So I think that's in the mix, and what we're starting to see now is a quite a significant shift, you know, quite a dramatic increase in the numbers of completed suicide.
There are the pressures of going to church and putting on a happy face and coming home, knowing that I wasn't happy at all. I'm not the happy person that everyone thinks I am because I put up a mask and just talk to everyone. I'm pretty good at hiding my true emotions.
You've just heard a dramatisation. This story is from one of the people interviewed by Dr. Jemima Tiatia. Dr. Tiatia did her doctorate on New Zealand-born young people's response to suicidal behaviour. It's the only research of its kind in New Zealand and gives an insight as to why young Samoans aged between 16 and 25 attempt suicide.
Initially, it was like an angry moment that set them off, and the majority of young people I spoke to, they weren't under the influence of any alcohol or drugs, so it's impulsive, and anger seemed to be the driving factors. But as I got speaking to them, it was more than just that isolated moment. It was a build-up of other things, whether, you know, through their families, their communities, their friends, you know, bullying, sexual orientation, physical discipline, sexual abuse, you know, all those difficult kind of issues.
Just the same old story, you know. Getting a wasting, a beating for doing the littlest thing. I came home late from school. You see, that's how they communicate with us kids. Those slap the mouth ones or a flying punch here and everywhere. I was just sick of it, I suppose.
Some of the cases is this boyfriend-girlfriend breakup, this Romeo-Juliet scenario. And you'll find that, you know, that was the one person they'd poured all their heart into, all their love into, because they weren't getting that in other places. So once you lose that, once you lose that ultimate support system that they consider as ultimate support system, what are they left with? They feel they've no other coping mechanisms.
I just, like, wanted to finish it, you know. No more getting jealous, no more getting angry, and no more getting pissed off at the little things, niggly little things with the old lady. And then when I woke up and it was, damn, what have I done?
Sexual things are occurring in our younger population at a younger age. Now, I don't have a lot of evidence to back that up compared to what happens at home in the islands. Because kids have got instant means of communicating with each other without parental or adult oversight, they're forming much deeper, intimate connections that might have been delayed by a few years back in a traditional society. And that delay is really important. I think a 17-year-old deals with relationship difficulties much better than a 16-year-old. And I think a 16-year-old does it much better than a 14-year-old. And so I think just in the space of in a short period of time, kids mature emotionally and deal with emotional insults much better.
Another reason New Zealand-born Pacific children are vulnerable is financial.
There was the financial obligation, especially with the older young people, because it was an age group from 16 to 25, I mean, they're working. So a lot of that obligation, that whālawelawe, and was becoming pressurizing. The eldest sibling or the eldest child was feeling a lot of that pressure in terms of the added responsibility. Also living up to the family name, that was huge. Not bringing the family name into, you know, into shame.
Oh man, they're so into that. They're like, you have to keep the family name clean, you know. Don't go off and do this, and don't go off and do that. And to me, that's just like pressure as well as expectations.
Communication is a huge area of concern, but in the modern world where it's readily available, what with mobile phones, texts and the internet, surely we should be doing better. There are pros and cons in technologies like social media.
You could argue that at least it's being expressed, you know, that any communication is a good form of communication. The reality is, though, that they're communicating to other young people who don't have the necessary maturity to deal with that type of distress. And so if they're sharing it around through a group of friends, through a network, a social media site, there's nobody within that social media site that's saying to them, look, you know, we need to have this conversation in this forum. There are things that need to be done that can make you feel differently about the world. So I'm not convinced that it's absolutely the best thing, but it's a reality that we have to deal with.
So we've heard some of the reasons Pacific young people are taking their lives, but how do you know if your child is vulnerable?
What we tend to see is some subtle signs, and the subtle signs are school performance starts to drop away. School attendance starts to drop away, that there is this emotional reactivity, there's a conflict between them and friends and family, so there's an underlying conflict. And then the subtle signs are, you know, they're not coming out of their room, they're coming home, going, doing their studies, not necessarily talking, not communicating. I think the really cardinal thing for families to watch out for is that loss of communication. So when their young people are withdrawing from them as adults, what is it that they need to do to re-establish that connection with the young person so that the young person's feeling comfortable enough to talk?
When we come back, what's happening around the country? Where are our young people in danger? Where are they taking their lives?
If you're going to do it, that's it. It's finished.